So now you've learned how to create basic functions. Let's look at how we can play with the parameters we passed into those functions, because there are a few things we can do in that space. You already saw that we can create a function which accepts a parameter and that can return values. So just to review, we'd seen we created a function here called getInitial. When you call getInitial, you pass in a name. So here we have the call in our code that's calling getInitial, and it passes in a first name. Whatever is passed in gets used in the code wherever you see the word name. And when this function is completed, it returns a value. And that value that's returned, when I call the function, I have to have a place to put it. So in this case, when I call getInitial, the value I receive back from the function gets put into the variable firstNameInitial. All right. One of the things I'd realized in my last one when I was writing this function is that, you know, maybe if somebody enters their name in lowercase letters, I still want initials to be returned in uppercase letters when I'm, maybe if I'm using this instead to create a user ID or an email address. So I've added this dot upper here to always make sure the initial returns in uppercase. And that, I think, makes a lot of sense if we're using it to extract initials for a user ID. But what if it's an email address? Email addresses, I don't always want uppercase letters. So I want, sometimes I want you to be able to say, make it uppercase, but maybe not always. Well, that's okay, because I can actually pass multiple parameters to my function. So what I can do is I add a second parameter called force uppercase. And when you call my function, you tell me whether you want false, don't force the initial to be uppercase, or true, do force the initial to be uppercase. And then inside my function, I say, if you've said I want it forced uppercase to true, then return it forced uppercase, otherwise whatever case was passed in. So you can pass multiple parameters to a function, but make sure if you do have multiple parameters, make sure you pass the parameters in the order they're declared. So you'll notice I have the parameter name and the parameter force uppercase. When I call it, I pass in the first name, the value for name, and I pass in false, the value for force uppercase in that order. So now I have a little more flexibility in what I can do with my function. It can get a little confusing, though, when you're worrying about the order in all these different situations. So we'll see some more tricks we can do. One of the things we can do is we can specify a default value for our parameter. Now, what's neat about this is I might say, you know, most of the time, you probably want me to always return initials in uppercase. So what I'm going to do is say that the force uppercase is defaulting to true. So what that means is if you don't give me a value for force uppercase, I'm always going to say true for force uppercase. So now when I call the function, in this case, you'll see I didn't even pass in a value for force uppercase. I can pass in a value if I want to. I can pass in the value true, I can pass in the value false, or I might just say, you know what, I'm going to give you a value first name, just use the default for the other parameters. This is another one of those things you'll see a lot when you look at tutorials and blog posts. You'll be like, how come over here when they call it, they passed in four or five values, and over here when I called it, I only passed in one value. What's going on? What's happened is the person who created the function has some default values for the parameters. And it may be that the default values work fine for a certain situation. So when you're calling a parameter or looking up documentation for functions, take a look and see if some of the parameters have default values. If they do, that means you don't have to pass in a value for them. It's optional. Something else we can do that I find is a really good habit because it makes your code a lot more readable is to do what's called named notation when you pass in parameters. Earlier I said you have to pass in the parameters in the order in which they're defined. So if I have a parameter name and force uppercase, you have to pass me in the name and then the value force uppercase. That was only a half truth. If you're using what we call positional notation, meaning the position of the parameters lets the function know which parameters go with which values, that's what you have to do. But there's something else called named notation. And what that does is when I call the function, I can say, hey, for that parameter force uppercase, I would like you to set a value to true. For the parameter called name, I would like you to use the value of first name. So in this case, doesn't matter what order I specify them in because I'm telling the function, here's the value for the first for force uppercase, here's the value for name. By naming the parameters, it doesn't matter what order I specify them in. And I still have that option if there are default parameters, default values for the parameters, they're still optional to specify. What I love about doing it this way, all executes the same, is how much easier it makes your code to read. I have done a lot of systems where we had to log errors when things went wrong in our code. And you would sometimes see code like this. Somebody creates, one of the coders on our team, creates a function that we pass it the error message and the error code and what time the error occurred and all these parameters. And it would then say, ooh, if that's the error that happened, I'm going to log it in this database over here and put it in this file with all these particular actions. And you'll see calls like this in the code. Somebody calls the error logger and it says, ooh, call error logger, pass in the values 45, 1, true, second number greater than first, my math method. Okay, I'm not sure what those values are telling me, but I guess that's the right values. So if I'm, you know, told later I need to go fix this person's code, I get really confused when I read a statement like this. What if I rewrite that a little bit and I use the named notation here? And suddenly it says, call the error logger, pass in an error code of 45, an error severity of 1. Log to database, set that to true. The error message is second number greater than first, and the source module was my math method. Oh, suddenly I can almost guess what the values are I should pass in whenever I call error logger because of this named notation. So it's a really useful trick and makes your code much easier to read for yourself when you come back to it later, or for someone else who has to try and understand your code. So the named notation makes your code a lot more readable. Let's go try this out in some code.